Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, the ENT Resident. Today's topic of discussion is going to be a disease in the nose, which is called as rhinoscleroma. Now let's get started. What is rhinoscleroma? Rhinoscleroma is actually a chronic granulomatous condition of the nose, a disease in the nose, which is caused by a gram-negative bacillus. Can you tell me what is the name of this gram-negative bacillus? This gram-negative bacillus is called as Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis. And this bacillus also has another name given to it, known as the Frisch bacillus. So rhinoscleroma is a chronic granulomatous disease of the nose, which is caused by a gram-negative bacillus called the Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis, also known as the Frisch bacillus. Now, this name was given by a person known as Juan Hebra, and hence the disease, the nose, the typical feature that you see in this disease came to be termed as Hebra nose after Juan Hebra. Now, let's move on to discussing other factors about the disease. Now, this disease is common in the northern states of India more than the southern states. Can you tell me one disease which is more common in southern India than northern India? And this is a disease, a chronic granulomatous disease involving the nose. That disease is rhinosporidiosis. So rhinoscleroma is more common in North India and rhinosporidiosis is more common in South India. Next, the age. This disease actually occurs at any age, but the most common age that it is seen is second to the third decade of life. And when it comes to sex, it is seen in both males and females, but there's a slight female preponderance here compared to males. Next, we move on to etiology of the disease. This disease is actually multifactorial. It has been commonly seen in the lower socioeconomic status. And hence, it has been hypothesized that it could probably be as a result of poor nutrition and poor hygiene as well. And as I've already mentioned, the causative agent is a gram-negative bacillus known as Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis. Next, we move on to pathogenesis. Now, what is the pathogenesis of this disease? It is the exact mode of infection is not known yet. But if we had to talk about the mode of transmission of this disease, this is an airborne disease. It has been suspected that direct inhalation of the droplets or contaminated material leads to the development of this disease in the host. And patients are usually seen to be immunologically normal. And there's a specific feature seen in this disease where you basically, there is ineffective phagocytosis of the causative organism by Michelin's cells. And the cause for this is the Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis has a mucopolysaccharide capsule. And that could be the reason why it leads to inhibition of phagocytosis, and hence that leads to the pathogenesis of the disease. Next, let's discuss what is the pathology of the disease. When we discuss pathology of the disease, we describe it in two parts, gross and microscopical features. First, let's talk about the grossly, what do you see? What is the first part of the first affected part of the body? The first affected part of the body in this case is the vestibule of the nose. But it has also other sites like the whole of the nose, larynx, trachea. And because all of these involve the respiratory passage, this disease is also known as scleroma respiratorium. Now, this disease, when it develops in the vestibule of the nose, it has a very characteristic feature where when you touch the nose, it has a very woody feel on palpation. You can also call this a woody nose. Next, we move on to microscopy of this disease. Now, microscopically, there are two diagnostic features that you will be seeing in this disease. One is the Michelin's cells, and second is Russell bodies. Now, this is a very common question that's asked. What are Michelet cells and what are Russell bodies? How would you describe them? These two pictures that you see on the right side, the first one is the Michelet cells. Michelet cells are basically these large foam cells. You can see that these are these large foam cells with a central nucleus and a vacuolated cytoplasm which contains the causative bacillus, which is the Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis. So these are the foam cells. And you can see that there is a vacuolated cytoplasm all around and there is a central nucleus. And these foam cells contain the Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis. These bodies are known as Michelet cells. Next is Russell bodies. The second picture that you see over here shows Russell bodies. What are Russell bodies? Russell bodies are these homogeneous eosinophilic inclusion bodies which are found in plasma cells. You can see these. These are Russell bodies. And why do these Russell bodies form? They form because there is an accumulation of immunoglobulins which is secreted by the plasma cells. So these two histological features are the diagnostic features of this disease. Other than this, you also see an infiltration of the submucosa with plasma cells, lymphocytes, and eosinophils. So this is about the pathology of the disease. This is some the histological picture that you see over here. This is something that is very important. Even in your practical exams, you are shown a slide like this and you're told to identify that disease that you're seeing. In this case, you have to remember the appearance of Michelet cells and Russell bodies, and this will help you in clinching the diagnosis. Next, we move on to microbiology of the disease. This is already something that I've mentioned. It's caused by a gram-negative bacillus. This bacillus is encapsulated and non-motile, and it is a diplobacillus. And how do you do a microbiological diagnosis? When you find a positive culture in McConkie agar medium, this is very diagnostic of rhinoscleroma. Next, let's discuss the clinical features of the disease. Now, this disease progresses in four stages. The first stage is the prodromal stage or the catarrhal stage. Now, what do you see in this stage? In this stage, you will see there is a congestion of the nasal mucosa. And the patient will complain to you that the patient has a runny nose. It can be a purulent rhinorrhea. It is very commonly mistaken for common cold at this stage of the disease when the patient comes to you at this stage, because it does not have all the diagnostic features that you need to clench the diagnosis. So it can be very difficult to diagnose at this stage. The next stage is the atrophic stage. Now, in atrophic stage, the most common presentation that you see is nasal block. And this nasal block is associated with crusting and some atrophic changes in the nose. You can also see epistaxis. And this stage actually can have similar features to another disease that I have mentioned before, which is atrophic rhinitis. Atrophic rhinitis is a disease that I've already mentioned before, where it is characterized by atrophy of the turbinate bones, the nasal mucosa, the arteries. And this stage of rhinoscleroma, the atrophic stage of rhinoscleroma, it can have features which are very similar to atrophic rhinitis, and hence here, atrophic rhinitis would be a differential diagnosis for you. Next, we proceed on to the third stage, which is the nodular or the granulomatous stage. This is the first picture that you see over here. This is when the vestibule of the nose gets affected and it has a woody feel on palpation. And the second picture you see is the condition known as Hebra nose. Now, in the nodular or the granulomatous stage, there are multiple indurated, irregular, reddish, rubbery lesions. Multiple indurated, irregular, reddish, rubbery lesions which are seen, which bleeds on touch. And these nodules will have a cartilage-like consistency. And these nodules ultimately coalesce together and they form a pale and a hard granuloma. Very severe cases will lead to broadening of the nose, and this leads to the characteristic Hebra nose. And Hebra nose is named after the scientist von Hebra. And at this stage, laryngeal involvement can lead to dyspnea or stridor. And very frequently, you are able to isolate the bacteria in this phase. So this is a very important stage, the nodular or the granulomatous stage, which gives rise to the characteristic features that you find in rhinoscleroma. And lastly is the stage of cicatrization. What happens, what does cicatrization means? Cicatrization is basically characterized by fibrosis and strictures. So there is a fibrosis of all the involved areas leading to vestibular stenosis, nasopharyngeal strictures, stenosis of the pharynx, larynx. And the commonest area in larynx which gets stenosed is the subglottis region. The fibrotic deformity of external nose is called as tapir nose. So there are two different terms you need to remember, Hebra nose and tapir nose. Hebra nose is seen in the third stage, which is the nodular or the granulomatous stage. And tapir nose is seen in the fourth stage of the disease, which is the cicatrization stage. You can also have fibrosis of the eustachian tube orifice, in which case the patient will present to you with features of otitis media with effusion, like blockage in the ear, not able to hear properly, a diminished hearing for the ear on the affected side. There can also be extensive cicatrization, adhesion and puckering of nose, soft and hard palate, which can lead to a distortion of the face. This is a very extensive phase of the disease when the disease has progressed a lot. There is no ulceration seen in this phase and malignant change has also been seen. There is another sign called the Gothic sign seen in this stage, where because of the fibrosis that is happening, the pharyngeal wall gets pulled up and resembles the top of a church. This is a V-shaped palatal sign which you see in X-ray. Uncommon sites involved in case of rhinoscleroma are the bronchus, trachea, lacrimal glands, maxillary sinus and alveoli. But the first site to get affected, as I've mentioned before, is vestibule of the nose. Next, let's talk about what are the investigations you'll do to diagnose this disease. First of all, the classical clinical presentation should raise suspicion to you when the patient comes with those particular features. You should already be suspicious of what it could be. But the clinching diagnosis here would be a biopsy of the mass that you see in the nose, and a histopathological examination will confirm the diagnosis when you see the maculate cells and the Russell bodies in this. This will be the characteristic features of histopathological examination in this case. You'll also perform a diagnostic nasal endoscopy of the nose to see how much it has involved, what structures have been involved, and you can also do an X-ray. You can do an X-ray of the nose and paranasal sinus where the features that will be seen are a diffuse soft tissue shadow in lower half of the nasal cavity obstructing it. There can be a partial destruction of the outer wall with asymmetric nasal expansion involving the turbinates and septum. Patent and a wide nasal cavity with thinned walls in the atrophic stages, and this would be the stage where you could confuse it with being atrophic rhinitis. There will be a narrow or obliterated nasal cavity with collapse of two lateral walls in the late fibrose stage, and concentric mucosal thickening in sinuses, which is the main sign in the active stage of the disease. There can also be an expansion of one or more sinuses with thinning or complete destruction of the wall. The features that you'll see in the mouth and pharynx is a partial or a complete obliteration of the nasopharyngeal wall because of fibrotic adhesions which form because of the deformed soft palate with the posterior pharyngeal wall. The signs that you'll see is the Gothic sign, as I've mentioned before, and a palatal V sign. In a lateral view of the skull, you can see some irregular soft tissue shadow in the upper lip, nasal ala, and cheeks. And in the larynx, there can be a localized small soft tissue shadow in case it has been involved. And the site which is most commonly involved here is the subglottic region. There can be a bilateral diffuse thickening of the subglottis, which results in narrowing of the air column. And in later stages, subglottis is seen as a very narrow structure affecting the entire contour, giving it a bottleneck appearance. So subglottic involvement is very common over here, but supraglottic and glottic involvement is very rare. If this involves the trachea and the bronchi, you can see a diffuse irregular narrowing in the areas. Now that you have made the diagnosis, how are we going to treat the disease? The first option here is using antibiotics because this is a bacterial infection. Now, what antibiotics are you going to use? There's two antibiotics that is used here. One is streptomycin and the second one is tetracycline. The dose of streptomycin is 1 gram per day and tetracycline is 2 gram per day. And the drug of choice over here is tetracycline. This is usually, these two drugs are usually given together for a minimum period of 4 to 6 weeks. And then depending on what is the condition of the progress of the patient, it can be repeated after 1 month. Depending on the progress of the patient and how the patient is responding to the treatment. There are some other antibiotics as well, which is used like ciprofloxacin and rifampicin. Now, when do you think, how do you decide whether the disease has been resolved and you have to stop the antibiotic treatment? The way to resolve that is, treatment is stopped only after 2 consecutive cultures from biopsy materials comes out to be negative. And if the patient has not responded, even after this, you will decide that this means that there has been a failure of medical management. Next, let's talk about steroids. What is the role of steroids in this case? Steroids will help you in reducing the fibrotic features that is happening, as well as it will also reduce the acute inflammation that is happening in this disease. So this is the role of steroids in rhinoscleroma. Next is radiotherapy. Now, a low dose radiation is used in this case, where a radiation of 3000 to 3500 rads per 3 weeks is used in very advanced resistant cases only, where it has not responded to any medical management. But however, this will not lead to the treatment or cure of the disease. This will only halt the progress of the disease. That is the role of radiotherapy in rhinoscleroma. Last of all is surgery. Now, in surgery, usually when all these granulation tissue forms in the nose, those can be removed with cautery or laser. And if the patient has progressed to the fourth stage, which is the cicatrization stage, where there is fibrosis and stricture, airway can be dilated and you can put polythene tubes as spacers so as to improve the airway. And plastic surgery is something that is considered at a very later stage of the disease. But this is only done after it has been confirmed that the disease has reduced and the patient is completely free of the disease. That is only when 3 consecutive biopsies are negative. That is when plastic surgery can be done for the cosmetic reasons. That finishes the treatment part. Now let's talk about what are the complications you could see. The complications could be an external nose deformity, which we already described as Hebra nose and tapered nose. There can be a vestibular stenosis, cicatrization of soft palate, nasal regurgitation, tracheal stenosis, subglottic stenosis, and malignant changes. And lastly, let's discuss what could be the possible differential diagnosis when a patient like this comes to you. What are the other possible causes you'll be thinking about? These include tuberculosis. These are basically all the other chronic granulomatous conditions which involve the nose, like tuberculosis, leprosy, lupus, fungal causes, syphilis, vaginal granulomatosis, Stewart's granuloma, sarcoidosis, leishmaniasis, eosinophilic granuloma, benign and malignant tumors. And the other one is atrophic rhinitis, which resembles the second stage of the disease, which is the atrophic stage of the disease. So this finishes all you need to know about rhinoscleroma. If you have any questions or any doubt, you can put it down in the comment section and I'll get back to you. Thank you.